That if you're going to build a championship football program, and of course I was one of the big uglies on the offensive line, you got to have offensive play line and defensive line. And one area that's absolutely no concern to the Detroit Lions is the defensive line. We're joined by a guy you're all well aware of because you hear me talk about him and you see him on the program all the time. Sean Cody, Detroit Lions defensive tackle. Sean, good to have you here, brother.
Hey, nice being in.
You know, I'm so, you know how much I like you personally, and I love, you know, kibitzing with you in the locker room and stuff. And I said this to Rayola, and I'll say it to you. I love the way you play football. You're a football player. I don't see you being a dancer. I don't see you being a restaurant owner. Although I bet you and I could do some
damage at a
buffet.
I could be a model. Look.
Okay, you could be a model. Okay. No thong bikinis here, buddy. But you know what I mean? You're a football player. It's your passion. Would you talk about that?
That's been installed in me, you know, as a kid. I've always been a hard worker, and I think that's the biggest part of football is just being able to have that work ethic and be able to work. And my father, my mom installed that in me as a young age, and I've grown up with it. You know, having coaches like, you know, Pete Carroll and my defensive line coach at SC, USC was Ed Ogeron. Those guys, they know how to work, and they instilled that in me, and that's how I play football. I work hard and try to push the limits.
Last year at Green Bay, freezing, miserable, cold.
Yep.
And I'll never forget, because I'm standing right out next to the bench, and there's that big heater, and you were there, and it was just miserable cold. And the thought that I had said to my camera guy was, I said, look at Cody. I said, you know, coming from California, this has just got to be miserable for him. And you were smiling. And it was almost like you were, I'm at Green Bay.
Mm-hmm.
This is the frozen tundra. Talk about that NFL last year, just being in the league, because you loved it, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you dream about it as a kid, and I'm on the field with Brett Favre and the frozen tundra here in Green Bay. It's amazing, you know. Playing football for me is just so much fun. I get on Sundays, I go out there, and I just have fun. I could be, you know, snowing. It could be 105 degrees. It's just fun for me to have out there. And to be able to line up next to guys like Sean Rogers and all the defensive players on our team, Dre Bly, and all those guys, it's not realistic. It's almost like a fantasy out there. And you're just playing. It's having fun. I wish a lot of more guys could experience it because it's great.
As an ex-left tackle, you're a guy's nightmare. You have the fastest hands of a defensive tackle. I told someone one time, it's like machine guns. I talked to DeMuling about you. Your hands are so fast. Is it just natural speed? Did you have to really, I mean, what happened? Because
I got little arms. No one knows it. I got little arms, so they move quick. So that's one of my keys.
Think about that.
One of my keys is they move quick because they're so small. So when guys try to get on me tight, I'm able to shoot my arms faster because they don't weigh as much as other guys' arms, and so I can get around blocks real quick. So that's one of my secrets that I like to keep real low. So don't. So
we're just gonna keep it between us, right?
Real low. Don't talk about it too much.
Because it's amazing. Your hands are so fast. My God. And then the thing that really surprised me, and I guess you could be a dancer, is your feet are the same way. You're really good about the short steps and keeping your balance, aren't you? Because that's one thing that maybe people who don't play the game don't understand. It's short steps because no matter how big you are, a little guy can tip you over if you're off balance.
Yeah, long steps, you can't take them. You know, you got to get your feet in the grass, and that's where all your power comes from. So once you take that long step, you're in the air, you're off balance, you guys getting knocked around. So, but it's not just me. I didn't just pick up this by myself. Coaches have taught me this stuff and drilled this stuff in me. You know, coaches like, you know, Coach Marinelli's been working me my footwork and hands and stuff. So it's been a work in progress. You know, you're always trying to get better, but you know, hopefully it shows up on Sundays, the hand work and feet work.
What do you think of Coach Sarge? I like Marinelli a lot. I mean, I'm sold on this guy.
Coach Sarge.
You know what? I always call him Coach Sarge. I just expect to see a big cigar in him. I'm expecting him to kick me in the butt and tell me to go run. Mm-hmm. I love that mentality, don't you?
Oh, yeah. You can just feel the passion that he has for football, the intensity. It's like an aura around him. You know, when I first met him, I came up here. I remember just feeling the presence of him, the intensity he brings, you know, just the love of football and the passion. It's something special that I think a lot of players feed off of it. And I know I've talked to some of the guys on his defensive line in Tampa Bay, and they all talked about how they would feed off the energy he exudes and what kind of emotion he brings to the game. So it's definitely something that I think that's going to help the team a lot because we got a lot of talent here, and get that talent moving is going to be good.
You know, I interview after every game because I like the way you play, and the people in Lansing know I say this, but I'm going to tell you to your face. I was critical of some of the Lions' young players because as the season digressed, it was almost, in my opinion, at practice and at games, I didn't see the effort. You never stopped. You played hard. One memory that that really sticks out in my mind is watching you in Green Bay. You know, there's not a lot to play for at that point in the season. And then watching you at Pittsburgh, you played as if you were in the Super Bowl. You respect the game of football, don't you, Sean?
Yeah. I mean, I have fun with it. It's playing in, like in Pittsburgh, playing, you know, the Steelers, playing the Green Bay Packers. It's just, it's special, you know. You kind of, when you start playing, I even found myself in the middle of the season finding just playing football. And you got to remind yourself that, man, this is a dream. This is what I worked for my whole life. And to just go out there and just go through the motions will be doing the game an injustice, you know, because this is what people dream of doing. And for me to go out there and play in Pittsburgh and play in these places, it's been an unreal experience. And I just keep trying to remind myself that, man, this is it. Where else would you want to be right now than in these places? And you just have fun. It brings a smile on your face and you get to play football.
So talking back to the folks in Hacienda Heights.
Hacienda Heights represent.
I did my research, bro.
I like it. I appreciate it.
The thing that they talked about was the fact that you were a gym rat. You just wanted to play ball. Basketball, you were a great basketball player.
No.
You football. But, I mean, you were an athlete. You loved sports. One thing that makes me sick is when I see guys that step on an NFL field who have talent and they don't have passion.
Mm-hmm.
You got both. Does that bother you when you see guys that have talent but don't have that drive to just play?
I think it's frustrating more than anything to see those kind of guys that, you know, have just amazing talent. I've seen it throughout your career. You see, you know, a lot of players, you go up in high school and you go to college and you go to NFL and you see these guys are just unlimited talent and just not the drive and not the push. And it's tough to watch because, you know, you wish you had that, you know, all that talent they had and you want to put it in use. But it's just, I think it's frustrating more than anything. And you wish you could talk to him and tell him, but some of the players are just, you know, stubborn and they don't want to listen. But you just try to do what you do and try to push yourself and maximize your talents, I think.
Yeah. Well, the moment I knew I liked that guy with you was last year, and you guys didn't hit a lot in training camp, and I'm so glad that's going to change. But I watched Damian Woody drop the wood on you last year. I mean, powerful hit.
Yeah.
And the thing that I liked is you got right back up. And it was almost to me, you had a smile on your face and you hit him on the rear. It was, hey, that's okay. You just want to get better. You don't care if you're on the cover of Sports Illustrated. You don't care if you've got the newest ride. I mean, you want to get better. That's what's great about you, Sean. Talk about that, because that's just a mentality that makes great football players.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I've always in my career thought that, you know, practice makes it. Practice makes you the player. And last year, you know, practice was, you know, sometimes up, sometimes down. And I'm the kind of guy who likes practice always. I feel like if I'm not getting a good practice, I feel cheated at the end of the day. And, you know, Damian Woody's that kind of player. He's a Pro Bowl kind of guy. And for me to go up against him, my rookie, I'm just feeling like I'm getting better. If he's smacking me around, you know, punching me around at the beginning of my rookie year, that's a good thing for me. I'm getting better. And getting those reps against him is better than, you know, getting reps in anybody in the league because he's, you know, that kind of player. So I felt at an advantage to have that kind of player to go against.
Now, I was talking to Fred Mattu. I was talking smack with Fred. And I told him, I said, you know, what's it going to be like now? Cody's not your teammate anymore. You're going to have to drop the wood on him like what he did to you, aren't you?
Yep,
you're going to have to get a punch in there. Oh, it got to be exciting, though, for you to see another USC guy come in because they do have that winning edge.
Oh, yeah. Well, Coach Carroll's installed a great attitude in Fred. He's a worker. He's going to come in here and play as hard as he can. And I know he's got that intensity. He's got that Samoan aggressiveness. So it's a good thing for our team to have. And, you know, Fred's going to stir up some fire, and that's good because Fred's a great player, and he's going to bring some emotion with him. And we could use that definitely.
Now, I was teasing him about getting pointers to me on how to deal with the winter. Mm-hmm. So you're from California, you little California surfer boy. And, you know, and you're from out there, and you come out here to Detroit. I mean, the cold of Green Bay, what was that adjustment like for you? Because it had to be interesting.
It was tough.
Like, I remember at one point, didn't you tell me you didn't even have an ice scraper?
No, I didn't have any of that. Well, I'm so used to wearing sandals all the time. I remember the first time I came to work, and it was like, you know, 30 degrees, and I said, well, I can't wear sandals. I got to shut down. The sandal game is over. I got to quit with the sandals. So I remember putting the sandals away, and, you know, it's not the first couple of weeks. So the first couple of weeks, it's like, oh, it's cold. It's not bad. It's just that continuous day in, day out. Wake up for practice, it's freezing. In the morning I leave, it's freezing. So, but your body starts getting gradually, your blood thickens up, and it isn't bothering me too much anymore.